Hi, this is Fred from Profile, and today I'm talking with Mr. Stewart Bell. How's things?
Good, thank you. Thank you.
Good.
And you?
First, congratulations for the release back in February of the Antechambers of Being Part 2. Great album, by the way.
Thank you.
First, let me ask you quickly to elaborate on the story behind Citizen Kane as a band and Citizen Kane Stewart Bell as a solo project.
Well, Citizen Kane was formed in the early 80s by Cyrus, the vocalist, and Gordon Feeney, who had both previously played in together in a band called Not Quite Red Fox. And Not Quite Red Fox were famous for Turning Down Fish from Marillion when he first started his career, and they auditioned with him as a vocalist, and they turned him down. And the twist in that story is that Not Quite Red Fox then played at the Battle of the Bands, a gig turned him down in England, where Cyrus was propositioned by an up-and-coming band named Marillion to be their singer. And when Cyrus returned home, he lost contact with Marillion, and this is back in the days where contact numbers were just scribbled on a piece of paper, so it was easy to lose touch. But of course, as we know, that then left the position of vocalist for Marillion open, and we know obviously who filled that role. So a little twist there in the early days of Citizen Kane's history. So Citizen Kane, they gigged quite extensively in the 80s, during the neo-prog revival, and they were on the verge of a big record deal when Cyrus broke his arm, and that left him unable to play, and the whole thing kind of fell apart. Cyrus came back to Scotland, and a couple of years later he bumped into an old bandmate of his called Frank Kennedy. They used to play together again in a band called Circus. And at that time I happened to be in a blues band. It was my first band with Frank, and he introduced me to Cyrus and let him hear some of the progressive stuff that we'd been working on, and he suggested that we get together and work on the material. Initially we were called the Kleptomaniacs, then On Edge, I think it was, and then Cyrus decided to reinstate the name Citizen Kane. And as you probably know, we've produced several albums over the following years. Then after quite a long break, we released our final album in 2012, which was Skies Darken.
Yep.
And Cyrus had decided he'd said everything he wanted to say with Citizen Kane, and we both moved on to our own solo projects. And here we are now.
The Antechamber of Being is meant to be a trilogy. So what's the concept all about?
Well, the concept is, it's all about lucid dreaming, which is the ability to be aware that you're dreaming while you're actually in a dream. And of course, this knowledge that you're dreaming then allows you to become the creator of the dream world and manipulate and control the content of the dream from within. And it's something that I've been doing since I was 6 years old, when my older brother taught me how to become aware within a dream in order to allow me to conquer a recurring nightmare that I was having at the time. So the story on the album starts off with me learning that amazing ability as a child, overcoming the monster in the cupboard from the nightmare that I was having, and then the gradual development as I grew up with the ability to be aware within my dreams. And there's other things like the questions that arise when you grow up with such a vivid dream life, where there seems to be independent beings, for example, inhabiting the dream world. So questioning whether these beings are just projections from my own mind, or whether they're actual entities, the meanings behind certain dreams and symbolic dream symbols, and the weird sort of phenomena that's associated with the whole subject. Things like sleep paralysis, where I don't know if it's something you've ever experienced, where you wake up and you can't move, and you can still see dream images within your room, and it can be quite scary actually, but things like this were happening to me as I was growing up. And then there's other things within the album, other sort of dream-related concepts like time dilation, where you can dream for hours, while only minutes have passed in the real world. The fact that the events, the monsters, the entities, all the stuff in your dreams, it's all manifestations coming from your mind, coming from your subconscious. So, you know, the ultimate discovery for me growing up was that when you confront these manifestations, you know, these demons and entities within your dream, and you transform them in the dream by knowing that you're awake, you're actually transforming the specific thought pattern or the fear or phobia that's behind that. So it's kind of like a way of reprogramming yourself from the inside. And of course, the first album's all kind of wrapped up around a love story where I meet my wife in a dream before I find her in the real world. And then I dream of my son before he's born. And of course, that's starting to enter the sort of metaphysical, fictional side of things when I get to exercise a bit of creative license, which is a great thing, I suppose, about concept albums. You know, you can write about real events, but you can add a kind of fantastical, metaphysical element to it. You can embellish the real story with the potential sort of metaphysical speculation, you know, that surrounds that type of phenomenon. And, I mean, at the end of the day, it might turn out not to actually be speculation. You know, as I say on the album, the improbable, after all, is actually quite probable. We just have to look around ourselves to sort of see, you know, how improbable everything actually is. The second part of the trilogy, that continues with the stories from that same time period while I was growing up, and it delves a bit more into the darker side of my experiences, seeing clothes floating around the room at 3 years old, you know, when I was in sleep paralysis, not knowing that at the time, of course, experiencing heartbreak and depression at 10 years old because of a girl that I met in a dream. And again, that's another one of the songs, the stories on the second album, being visited by angelic figures and weird insects who seemed to be warning me of something terrible that was going to happen, or something that actually came to be in the real world. And it also looks at some of the deeper questions that experiencing these things prompt, you know, questions about consciousness and questions about the nature of the universe. I don't claim to have any answers to these questions, but they still intrigue me and inspire me, and of course have inspired the trilogy. So it's quite a big concept, as you can see.
Yeah, very interesting. About the music itself, like if someone walks in and don't know anything about Antechambers of Being, so how would you describe the music and its influences?
The music is good old school prog rock, I would say, inspired by the classics, Genesis, Yes, Rush, and the classic sounds, of course, Moogs, Mellotrons, Hammonds. And it's combined with newer elements of prog metal, neo-prog, symphonic prog. And of course, there's I use some more modern technology and sounds as well, which sometimes give an almost techno or electronica feel to some of the stuff. And it's good to kind of combine these different elements, you know, to try and do something original. And I'd say the music's also a lot like Citizen Kane, because I was the main composer for Citizen Kane, and I still write in the same way I did with Citizen Kane. Well, apart from the fact that the story and the lyrics are written before I start writing the music. That way of writing seems to add something new to the whole mix, because I always know where I'm going next, you know, what the theme of a particular song or a particular part is going to be, you know, because of the story and the lyric that's behind it. With Citizen Kane, I'd often get stuck with this type of thing because the lyrics are written after, so I'd struggle to know where do I go next. So now things flow a lot more easily. I think influences are still quite obvious in the music, with biggest influence being Marillion in the early 80s, and they're the band that got me into prog initially. And from there, getting into Genesis, Gabriel Era, Genesis, Jethro Tull, Rush, and ultimately then more obscure bands like Gentle Giant, PFM, Brand X, and some of the more sort of obscure prog from the early days. But for me, progressive rock was always about concept albums. It was something I was actually introduced to through more mainstream avenues around about 10 years old, with things like ELO's Time album and Jeff Wayne's War of the Worlds. These were two of my favourites when I was growing up, and they were both obviously concept albums. So writing a concept album has always been something that I wanted to do from scratch.
Yeah.
And I suppose it won't get any more epic than a trilogy of concept albums, although actually it might end up being a trilogy in four or five parts, because there's so much material and so many ideas and stories based on these experiences that I've had throughout my life. I also like to write an album as like one, you probably noticed, as one continuous piece, one song merging into the next. And again, my favourite albums, you know, from my early days, often did the same thing, like Misplaced Childhood, you know, War of the Worlds, and then some of my more recent favourite albums like Scenes from a Memory and Arion, stuff like Human Equation. You know, you've got one continuous, I don't like gaps between songs, basically, like fade outs. I like to just have, you know, that whole continuous thing.
Yeah.
So that's kind of the type of thing I would tell people about the album.
Collaborating with you again is Phil Allen, but also two hugest name in the progressive rock industry. One is Simone Rossetti from The Watch, and the second is the great Arjen Lucassen from Arion, who you just mentioned. Just to name these two. So how did such a collaboration happen, and will they appear in part three and maybe part four and five and so on?
It was great to work with these guys, you know, and to have them be a part of the album. Arion initially got in touch with me and asked, it was after Skies Darken, and he asked about some of the sounds that I'd used on that album. That was the last Citizen Kane album in 2012. So we got chatting about different synths and different sounds, and, you know, so I'd already made that contact with Arion. So when I decided I was going to be working on a concept album with guest singers, I felt it would only be right to have the god of concept albums and the master recruiter, Arion himself, playing a part on it. And he was very friendly and very professional, a pleasure to work with, as was Simone. Given that both of them have very busy schedules, they were both, you know, very professional during the whole process. Simone, I knew I wanted a Peter Gabriel type vocalist for the main part, but not someone too similar to Cyrus, or it would end up just sounding like a Citizen Kane album. And when I started searching for someone to fit that part, it turned out that a guy that had been a long-term fan of Citizen Kane, who also did reviews and interviews for various Italian magazines, he was actually the ghostwriter for The Watch, Simone's band. And he put me in touch with someone who, of course, he was exactly what I was looking for. And I also felt, I mean, as well, there's obviously Phil and Becca on the singing on the album also, because I felt that Phil, our guitarist from Citizen Kane, I felt he'd been underused as a vocalist in Citizen Kane's albums. He'd only really had a couple of parts, especially given how powerful his voice is, how amazing a voice he actually has. So I thought he should play a bigger part in my material. And I think his voice is a perfect contrast to Simone's, you know, and along with the other voices, I think it all kind of works really well. I hope so anyway.
Also, as a collaborator on your project is, sorry if I don't pronounce it right, but Becca Comrie, a female singer. Can you introduce her? Because we don't know her much here in Quebec.
Yeah, well, Becca is she's a local girl. She's very young. She's just starting out in her music career, to be honest.
Okay.
And I'd contacted a couple of bigger female sort of names within progressive rock circles, but I wasn't actually having much luck, to be honest. And Phil, who worked in a music shop, he suggested a friend of a friend, and Becca came along and did the audition, and she was perfect for the part. She has an amazingly powerful voice for such a wee thing, and again, she's very professional. I hope to have her and all the other vocalists resume their roles in part three, and possibly maybe add a couple of new names to fill the extra parts that will be needed for that story. So, yeah.
Yeah. Well, I don't think that it's the last time we hear from her.
No, definitely not.
Hear of her. You went through a campaign in order to finance the release of Tome 2. More and more bands take this direction nowadays. How did it go, and would you do it again?
Well, the fundraiser, it went well, although it didn't actually reach its funding goal. But luckily, it was something called flexible funding, where whatever money is raised still goes towards the project. It did mean that things were delayed quite a bit until I, you know, managed to secure the rest of the funds to complete the album. And ultimately, it meant giving F2 Music an exclusive distribution deal again, which, you know, did the same thing with part one, which is great that they're there to, you know, to help out financially, but it does limit things a bit in some respects.
Yeah,
obviously it cuts into my profit when someone else is getting a share, and the things like me producing the special edition hardback art book becomes a problem. I think you have a copy of that there. because that you know, that takes away sales from the distributor if I'm doing something different, something special, you know. Lovely stuff. And
beautiful.
Obviously, if he isn't going to make his money back, he obviously doesn't want to get involved. So the fundraiser allowed me to produce the special edition, but only, like I say, in a very limited quantity. So there is only something like 110 copies of that. So it's very, very limited and collectible, I suppose. It's unfortunately sold out now. But the fundraiser also allowed me to pay the artists without having to wait till everything was finalised with the distributor. And yeah, I'd do it again. I'm pretty sure the fans are patient and understanding enough to wait that little bit longer if things don't go to plan. You know, when the funding goal, if a funding goal isn't reached. So definitely use that method again, and will do in the future.
Yeah, you mentioned about the formats. Well, part one and part two are available not only on CD, but they're also available, like you said, on the hardback art books. Well, first, congratulations, because this is really, really nice product.
Thank you.
The art is beautiful. Like, and I'm curious now, why not just a CD or a vinyl like anybody else? Like, why would you go through all this? Anyway, I'll let you answer that one.
Yeah. Well, after producing the storybook that accompanied part one, The Cupboard of Fear that came out along with part one, I planned to do a similar thing with this album. And it was actually going to be a second storybook on the topic of sleep paralysis. The first storybook, of course, is about lucid dreaming, overcoming nightmares in a lucid dream. The second one was going to look at overcoming sleep paralysis, which is actually going to be called the feet. It's still going to happen, but it's going to be called The Feet Tickling Goblins and the Dance of Empty Clothes. So, because sleep paralysis is something, again, that most children, you know, like nightmares, most children and adults experience at some point in their life. And instead of it being a scary experience, it's something that can be overcome, you know, and it's something that can be used to enter a lucid dream. But as it turned out, the time was short. I didn't want to rush the storybook, so I decided to go for produce the artbook instead. I thought it would be beneficial, given the nature of the concepts on the album, it would be good for the listener to have some kind of background to the stories, you know, and some background to the concepts that are on the album, rather than it just being a book. Instead of just being a book full of stories, I thought a few nice illustrations would also make it more appealing, you know, just not just a big wall of words about lucid dreaming. And I think as well, if there's something available as opposed to just a regular CD, many people will be encouraged to buy that rather than going for a download or going for streaming, you know, have something nice that they can have on their shelf.
Yeah.
And I've always liked having a nice package when I buy an album, you know, having something to read through or a DVD to watch and some nice artwork to put a picture to the music. So I think it enhances the experience, definitely. I still plan to produce the second storybook, the Feet Tickling Goblins of the Dance of Empty Clothes, and hopefully that'll be this year, time permitting. And I'm pretty sure if The Cupboard of Fear, the first storybook, if that wasn't the most obscure kids' storybook ever, this new one will be, you know. I don't think there's any kids' storybook about sleep paralysis out there. So it'll be unique at least.
Yeah. So we can expect the part three sometimes in 2017?
Part three, but it will probably be a little bit later than this year, I would imagine. It's a big undertaking.
Yeah.
The story and the lyrics have been complete, you know, for a while. And what I tend to do is, once the lyrics are finalised, I kind of run through the song structures in my mind before I actually write anything. Just kind of planning out how things are going to go, which themes are going to recur here and there, and you know which parts are going to sort of go with each other, the style, sort of feel of each part, you know, that type of thing. It's kind of written. It's already written up here, you know. But I actually plan to release a mini album before part three.
Oh.
Because I have a lot of ideas for songs that aren't, you know, that aren't related to the overall story in the trilogy. Stuff that's come up.
Like a transition
album. Yeah. So material that's more, I want to do something that's more sort of song based.
Okay.
The lyrics, again, with that, the lyrics are written and the mental song structuring has been done, so they're all ready to go. I've actually just completed the first song for that album this week. And as part of that mini album, which hopefully will be this year, I hope to remix some of the tracks from the first part of the trilogy. Again, giving them a more sort of song-based feel, so that they'll hopefully appeal to a wider audience, because I'm aware that a concept album as a 74 minute continuous piece of music can be off-putting even for some prog fans. So I'd like to produce something a wee bit more accessible so that the story can reach more people,
yeah.
You know, and the music can reach more people. My own experience with getting into prog music was actually through Marillion's, you know, the more commercial songs like Kaylee and Lavender. So, you know, if I can kind of get people's attention with this more sort of song-based album and these more song-based versions of songs from the first album, you know, that can only be a good thing. I might release the storybook that I was talking about. I might release that along with the mini album. So, you know, that might be another sort of special edition. And there's also the possibility that, as I was saying earlier, part three might end up being done in two parts, because it's quite a big concept. I wouldn't know until I start writing, of course, but you know, there's a lot of stuff there, so it might end up as a quadrilogy.
Yeah.
I don't know what a five-part trilogy is, but I don't know what the name for that is, but it'll just keep going, I think, just forever. Yeah.
I can only imagine the final box set of this trilogy, right? It would be awesome with the whole book, right? Well, you got us worried last year. We found out that Citizen Kane was more than likely to be over. Can you share a little bit about this and what we can expect in moving forward?
As I said earlier, after Citizen Kane's last album, Sky's Darkling, Cyrus decided that he'd kind of said everything that he wanted to say with Citizen Kane. And although I was a bit hesitant at first, you know, didn't want to accept that it was over, Once I got into writing my solo stuff, I realised, you know, it was the way forward. And Citizen Kane wasn't really going anywhere. We'd never managed to get a full band together since the 90s, so, you know, we couldn't gig. And without gigging, the fan base stayed the same over the years. Mm-hmm. To be honest, it was kind of over after Playing Dead came out in 2002. Because I realised, you know, that we were never going to gig and things were never going to progress beyond albums just kind of breaking even, you know. It was an expensive hobby that paid for itself, basically.
Yeah.
And I actually got a proper job, and although I kept writing, there wasn't really any incentive or desire to kind of get things going, you know, to finish that next album. Hence the 10-year gap between Playing Dead and Sky's Darken. The thing is, during that time, I went through a bit of a sort of transformation and sort of reevaluated my goals and my drives, and I deconstructed quite a lot of my old belief systems and went through a process of kind of deprogramming a lot of the crap that had been left over from my childhood, which was a childhood filled with religious indoctrination. So it kind of put me in a better place and the perfect place to finish the final Citizen Kane album and then move on to writing my own stuff. You know, and it gave me the inspiration to tell my own story as well.
Yeah.
Because these were all things that I'd rarely spoken about, things that were considered kind of, you know, they were always kind of looked at as being kind of weird or supernatural. I think when you mention lucid dreaming to someone, they just assume it's this kind of weird hippie, you know, sort of spiritual hippie thing, you know, and you get some funny looks when you bring up the subject. But I suppose it is still kind of considered as a new age sort of hippie endeavour. And but really, I mean, it's a scientifically proven thing now, lucid dreaming. And during that time, I suppose, I kind of learned to write music just for the hell of it, you know, not worrying about whether it was going to be successful or make a shitload of money or, you know, because, I mean, it's progressive rock at the end of the day, it has its limits, you know, in terms making a fortune, you know. Mm-hmm. I think it was a good frame of mind, you know, that kind of just doing things for the hell of it, a good frame of mind to nurture when you're in the prog rock industry, or even the music industry in general these days, you know. Citizen Kane has kind of transformed into the solo stuff now. You know, it's not really over. It's just changed, really. You know, it's transformed, and of course Cyrus is working on his own solo project, which is called Black Moth. Black Moth, the Honeybee. Quite a mouthful. And there's actually a tribute to Citizen Kane on part three of the trilogy, of my own trilogy. Because in the story in part three, I find myself kind of looking back over my life. And of course, a big part of my life was music, and especially Citizen Kane. And I hope to have Cyrus as a guest on that song, along with some of the other guys that we've played with in Citizen Kane over the years. You know, it'll be a nice wee, almost like a nice little send-off for Citizen Kane, after it being such a big part of my life. So yeah, but it is pretty much over, yeah. I don't think there'll be any comebacks.
Okay.
Nothing planned at the moment.
Well, at least we have the Stewart Bell's version nowadays.
Yeah.
Unfortunately, we're almost done, but I have a few more questions that will require only one-word answers.
Really?
If you do not wish to answer them, you just say pass, and I'll move on to the next one. It's meant to be fun. So, what was the last album you purchased?
That would be the last Dream Theater album, Astonishing.
The Astonishing. What music genre were your parents listening to when you were young?
Oh, Country music mainly.
Country. One band you secretly like but never tell anyone about it.
Adam and the Ants.
Say that again.
Adam and the Ants.
Oh, yes. I do
tell now and again, but I was only young at the time.
What artist would you love to have a chance to work with?
Beethoven.
What is the last concert you attended?
Last concert was Marillion. Yeah.
The Fear tour?
No, it was the one before.
Okay. Do you or have you ever had a nickname, and share it if you want?
Uzi.
Uzi.
Don't ask me why. Uzi.
Action movies or comedy?
Comedy action.
Good answer. And the last one. If there was one song you wish you had written, which one would it be?
A song that I wish I had written? I'll have to pass that one. I can't think.
Well, Stewart, thank you very, very much.
Thank you.
Again, great, great album. I wish you the best luck with this one and moving forward to part 3 and maybe 4 and 5 and so on. So I'm thank you very much. You want to add anything before I let you go?
No. I think I've said enough. But thank you. Thanks for doing the interview and
all right.
Promoting the album and the website.
Have a good day.
Thank you. Have a nice one. Bye now.